Good evening.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you have called us to be your children. And tonight we want to think more on the plan of salvation and that the gospel really has power to help us to live the life that you want us to live. Bless in a special way. May your Holy Spirit guide in all that I will read and that it may impress our hearts to love you more. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I bring you greetings from our church in Armstrong, British Columbia. And also, I was told in Romania, where I spoke in about 7 churches, that just a couple of weeks ago, that I was definitely to bring greetings wherever I went from their churches there. I even spoke in a gypsy church over there. And it was a good experience. In Romania, they have a very strong Adventist group. Very active. All right, I want to share what God has helped me to put together on the power of the gospel. But first of all, we need to understand what is really needed in our hearts. When a rich young ruler came to Jesus, he said, "Good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" In Luke 18:18. And Jesus answered him and said, "If you would enter into life, keep the commandments." And the young man was very happy with that answer. He said unto him, "Which?" Jesus said, "Thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." Christ was drawn to this young man. He knew him to be sincere when he answered, "All these things have I done from my youth up. What lack I yet?" Good young man. Totally unaware that he was on the road to death. He didn't really keep the commandments. Because his conception, we are told in Christ's Object Lessons 391, his conception of the law was external and superficial, judged by a human standard. He had preserved an unblemished character. By whose standard? A human standard. An unblemished character in the sight of his parents, in the sight of his friends. To a great degree, his outward life had been free from guilt. He verily thought his obedience had been without a flaw. Good young man. Didn't kill, didn't steal, didn't lie, didn't do any of those things that the commandments told him not to do. Didn't commit adultery. But what was missing? Jesus came right to the point. And Jesus said, "Young man, go sell everything you have if you want eternal life, and then give to the poor and follow me." And then the young man realized he did not love his neighbor as himself. He did not want to share his riches with the poor. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end is the way to death. And he walked away from Jesus and stayed on the road to death. Very selfish young man. And no selfishness will go into heaven. We read in Desire of Ages 5:19, Christ read the ruler's heart. Only one thing he lacked, but that was a vital principle. Vital means it is absolutely essential. He needed the love of God in his soul. This lack, unless supplied, would prove fatal to him. He needed the love of God in his soul, not just human love. We read in John 13:35, by this all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. That is how we prove whether we are truly God's children. What is this love like? We have to know what it's like. And it tells us in 1 Corinthians 13:4-7, love is patient and kind. This is God's kind of love. Human parents often get impatient and even unkind with their children. But if we have God's love in the heart, we will be patient and kind, even when the children are disobedient. Because when children are disobedient, they are having a problem. And they need help, and they need prayers. And they need a lot of love to bring them on the right road. They don't need anger and impatience. But so many of us did it the other way. And we punished with impatience instead of with prayer. And we are told we should never lift our hand to discipline a child with a spanking before we have prayed with that child. And if they are brought to repentance, they then do not need the spanking. I didn't do it that way. Neither did my parents. My father especially, he always disciplined us in anger. We were supposed to be Christians, but somehow we didn't really understand how to have God's love in our hearts. I grew up in a Seventh-day Adventist home. My father was a very strong disciplinarian. We were 11 children, so he had much opportunity to discipline us, but also he could not control himself. He could not discipline himself. He would get impatient, he would get irritated, he would be angry, and sometimes very angry. What was wrong? He didn't know how to have God's love in his heart. And it says, love is not jealous or boastful. It is not arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. There would be no quarreling in families if we had this kind of love. But I insisted on my way. When my husband and I were rearing our children, I felt he was too harsh with them and selfish with them. And so I insisted on my way. I had grown up the second oldest of 11 children. I had worked with little children all my growing up years. And he hadn't done any work with children. And so I insisted that I knew better. And so we argued about this, and even in front of the children. Yet we thought we were Christians. We didn't understand God's love. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. And I had irritation. And I had resentment. Oh, I didn't lose my temper like my father. But I resented my husband if he didn't do it right. And I blamed him. You know, it's so easy to blame someone else when we get impatient because someone else didn't do what we wanted them to do, right? And so it's the natural thing to blame them. And so we blame our children. And you know what we do? The poor children are carrying their own guilt because they did wrong. They needed discipline. And then the parents get upset and irritated and put the blame for their sin on the children. Because if the children had obeyed, they wouldn't have gotten angry. You know, I just didn't realize what we were doing. And my father always blamed others when he got angry. Always. And Adam and Eve did that as soon as they sinned, didn't they? They blamed someone else. You see, it's natural when we're sinners. But Christians are not. You know, sometimes people say, but we are only human. If you are only human, you are not a Christian. Christians are connected with the vine. Christians have the Holy Spirit coming into the little branch, the Christian, and producing the fruit of the Spirit. And the first fruit of the Spirit is what? Love. Love. And so you can test yourself. Are you really a Christian? Is God's Spirit controlling you, or is your humanity controlling you? Christians have Christ in them, not standing outside and knocking at the door. And they understand the power of God's love. Now, they might fail once in a while, but they know immediately they stopped abiding in Christ, that it was not right, and they confess their wrong. They do not blame others when they fail, because we cannot blame anyone for our sin, can we? We cannot. No matter what people are doing, love is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrong, but rejoices in the right. Love bears how much? All things with patience, with kindness, without irritation, without resentment. My husband is a minister. We were missionaries in the Philippines and India for 10 years, and then we came back, and my husband was an editor at the Review and Herald for about 20 years before he retired. And yeah, we also thought we were Christians, and yet we had these problems, not big like my father's, but they were there. And when I came home from the mission field in 1970, I visited my parents. And my father was 78 at the time. He had a heart problem. He knew he could drop dead any time. And he knew his days were running out. And yet here he was, still had an 18-year-old boy at home who was giving him more trouble than all the other 10 children put together. This boy was born in his old age, 12 years after the other 10. So this was an only child in one respect. And at the beginning, he got spoiled, and then he couldn't be handled. And they were living in the city by this time, not in the country. And yeah, and here was my father wrestling with this child and realizing his life could end today, and he knew only the overcomer would be in heaven. The Bible says very plainly, to him that overcometh, and he was not overcoming. And so he was running scared. And he came to me, I'm a minister's wife, he expected me to have answers. And he said, Margaret, what is righteousness by faith? People have been talking about that lately. And that was in the early 70s, late 60s, where there was a lot of talk on righteousness by faith in our churches. And he was listening and he wasn't understanding. And so he said, what is it? I said, I don't know. And he said, but some of your sisters have been studying the subject. Listen, what they are finding. Tell me if it's truth or not. So I listened all Sabbath afternoon. And every once in a while, Father would turn to me and he would say, are they right? I would say, I don't know. You see, I had been a worker for God. I had not been a student of the Word. Oh, yes, I read my Bible. I read it through many times. But you know, you can read your Bible and get all the little stories that are there and not really understand the gospel. Not really understand how to connect with God in a living connection. And so I didn't understand righteousness by faith. And as the evening went on, my father got more and more concerned. And at the end, he cried, Margaret, help me! And I couldn't help him. I could have said, Dad, try a little harder. But in that moment, I knew that was not the answer. And I said nothing. And I went home determined I was going to find help for my father. And so I started to search the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. And at the beginning, it was hard. It was boring. I was a workaholic. I wanted to be out there working with children and doing something. But I made myself stay with it. And gradually, the Bible and the spirit of prophecy became living water and living bread to my soul. And then I wanted to spend hours studying, searching. I was finding life for myself. I realized in a short while that I was not a Christian. I was like the rich young ruler. I just had a form of religion. Unaware, I didn't have a living connection. And so I studied and I found answers, and then I prayed, now Lord, send me back to my father. 4 years later, the Lord arranged it, and I went back and shared with the family. We read here, in Sons and Daughters 49, many are deceiving themselves, for the principle of love does not dwell in their hearts. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 3, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove the mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all that I have and deliver my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain how much? Nothing. You see how serious this is? This is God's kind of love. And it tells us exactly what it's like. And it's the first fruit of the Holy Spirit. By their fruits ye shall know them. And like it says in John 13:35, by this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. After my husband and I discovered how to have this love in our hearts, our little daughter, our children were 22, 21, and 13 when we discovered real Christianity. And our little daughter went around the house singing, "Something's happened to Daddy, he's not the same anymore." She saw the difference right away. Even though we had a good home before, but it was different. And it says here, even if we give our bodies to be burned as martyrs, my father would gladly have been a martyr. He looked forward to the time of trouble where he could stand for the truth though the heavens fall. He would have been glad to be a martyr, but brothers and sisters, he would have gained nothing. Because in his home, with his family, he was not living God's love. And he was putting all the blame of his sins of the heart on others. How sad. And how could God help him if he blamed others for his failures? You see, totally ignorant of how to be a Christian. And it says here in Evangelism 152, I wish you to distinctly understand this point, that souls are kept from obeying the truth by a confusion of ideas, and also because they do not know how to surrender their wills and their minds to Jesus. They do not know how. They want special instruction how to become Christians. And so this is what I learned and what the Lord asked me to share. Are there others who were as deceived as I was? We read in John 3:1-2, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. And Jesus looked at Nicodemus. He saw he was sincere, he was searching for truth, and so he came right to the point, and he said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. Nicodemus was startled at the thought of a kingdom too pure for him to see in his present state. We read in Desire of Ages 171, he had felt secure of the favor of God. He felt he needed no change. He was irritated by Christ's words. You know, sometimes people say, but Mrs. Davis, you make us feel so lost. Praise God. I wish someone had come to me before I was baptized at the age of 14 and made me feel lost so that I could understand the true gospel. But all through those years, and even though my husband was a minister, We never understood. What was the problem with Nicodemus? Jesus said, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. We are all born of the flesh. But that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot see the kingdom of God. There was no excuse for Nicodemus. Ezekiel talks about the new birth. David talked about the new birth. And we read in Desire of Ages 1:7-2, he who is trying to reach heaven by his own works in keeping the law is attempting an impossibility. There is no safety for one who has merely a legal religion, a form of godliness. The Christian's life is not a modification or improvement of the old life. The Christian's life is not just getting rid of this sin or this sin or this sin. Just improving a little bit here and there. But a transformation of nature. There is a death to self and to sin, and a new life altogether. And this is the spiritual life that God has promised to give us if we will come to the foot of the cross. But I didn't even know what it meant to come to the foot of the cross. I didn't know what it meant to die to self. We read in 6th Bible Commentary 10:7-5, the new birth is a rare experience in this age of the world. This is the reason why there are so many perplexities in the churches. So many homes breaking up. The average number of homes breaking up in our church is about the same average as out in the world. How sad. So many children going out in the world. Many, so many who assume the name of Christ are unsanctified and unholy. They have been baptized, but they are buried alive. Self did not die. Therefore, they did not rise to a new life in Christ. That was the problem. We didn't understand how to die to self. How many of you, before you were baptized, were taught that you should give up the sins of the world, smoking, drinking, carousing, if you were doing those things? How many of you were taught you needed to give up the sins of the world before baptism? Most of you. How many of you were taught not only to give up the sins of the world, but to give all your heart sins to Jesus? The right to get angry, the right to be impatient, the right to have resentment, the right to get irritated. All these heart sins. How many of you were taught how to give those up before baptism? That's the problem, you see. We excuse our heart sins. And we may never have gone out in the world. I didn't. But I had heart sins, and I excused them. When I resented my husband, I blamed my husband. When I got irritated with my children, I blamed my children. Do you see? And that's the very essence of Christianity, of what we are, what's in the heart. Jesus said, give me your heart. Don't just give me the worldly sins, give me your heart. Are there others? You know, if we don't give him our hearts, how can he give us a new heart? How can he create a new heart and a new mind if we don't give him the old one? He can't do it. And so he stays knocking at the door. And he will stay there all through our lives until finally we understand. Are there others who were deceived? Let's think of the foolish virgins. Matthew 25, 1 through 4. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. 5 were wise, and 5 of them were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. It's very important we understand those two things, vessels and lamps. We read in Christ's Object Lessons. Christ's Object Lessons is the book that really opened my eyes because it explains all the parables of Christ. And so I began to understand what Christ was saying in these parables. We read in 406, 408, the two classes of watchers represent the two classes who profess to be waiting for their Lord. They are called virgins because they profess a pure faith. So these are very sincere people professing a pure faith. By the lamps is represented the word of God. So this is the lamp. The oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And so they were all praying for the Holy Spirit to enlighten them as they studied the Word of God. They all had oil in their lamps, and all their lamps were burning at the beginning. All have a knowledge of the Scriptures. For a time there was seen no difference between the foolish and the wise. When we come to church, we all look like wise virgins. You can't really tell unless you live in people's homes to know whether they are wise or foolish. How can you tell? By the fruit of the Spirit. Because it's the Holy Spirit that must be in the life. The oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. For a time there was seen no difference between them. So with the church that lives just before Christ's second coming. All have a knowledge of the Scriptures. All have heard the message of Christ's near approach and confidently expect his appearing. What are the foolish virgins doing? Confidently expecting Christ to come, totally thinking they are ready. Behold, the bridegroom comes. Go out to meet him. Many are unready. They have no oil in their vessels with their lamps. You see, they all carried a little vessel. What does the vessel represent? It represents us. We are called vessels in the Bible that are to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so it's not enough to just ask the Holy Spirit to enlighten you as to the Word of God. We must invite the Holy Spirit into the vessel. And that's what the foolish virgins had neglected to do. They did not understand. The Bible says in Romans 8, 9, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And how do you know whether the Holy Spirit is in control? By the fruit. Especially when you're being tempted to get upset. And if you have the fruit of the Spirit, if you know how to keep abiding in Christ, you will have the fruit of the Spirit. All had lamps, that is an outward semblance of religion, but only five had the inward piety. Five of them were wanting in the oil of grace. The Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, the Holy Spirit, was not abiding in their hearts. Without the oil of grace, of what use was it to bear about a lamp of profession? So we can profess to be Christians, but if the Holy Spirit is not invited into the life to control the life by the fruit of the Spirit, of what use is it? Because God looks at the heart, not just at the outward appearance. Here is the greatest deception that can affect the human mind. These persons believe they are right when they are all wrong. They are found wanting when it is forever too late. How sad. Forever too late. And then they knocked at the door of the bridegroom. And the bridegroom said, I don't know you. I don't know you. How sad. Brothers and sisters, can you imagine what the foolish virgins will feel like when Jesus comes? I don't even want to think about it, because these are sincere people. These are honest people. They really want to be saved. And they really think, just like Nicodemus, that they're on the road to heaven. We read in Christ's Object Lessons 4:11, the class represented by the foolish virgins are not hypocrites. They are not hypocrites. They have a regard for the truth. They have advocated the truth. They are attracted to those who believe the truth. But they have not yielded themselves to the Holy Spirit's working. They have not fallen on the rock, Christ Jesus, and permitted the old nature to be broken up. They have been content with a superficial work. They do not know God. It's very important that we think of these things. All heaven is waiting for channels through which to be poured the holy oil. Are there others who were deceived? Let's think of the wedding garment and the man who came without a wedding garment. We read in Matthew 22 and verses 2, 11, and 14. The kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king which made a marriage for his son. And when the king came in to see the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment. And he said unto him, Friend, how camest thou in hither, not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then said the king to the servants, Bind him hand and foot, take him away, cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. We are all called. Everyone in the world is called. Few will be chosen. Only those who have the wedding garment. What is the wedding garment? We read in Christ's Object Lessons 317, the parable of the wedding garment opens before us a lesson of the highest consequence. So it's very important we understand this teaching of Christ. By the marriage is represented the union of humanity with divinity. And so when we surrender ourselves to Christ, we give him all the heart, and Christ comes into the life, that's the marriage, that's the union. We are grafted into the vine. That's the marriage, the union of humanity with divinity. And that is called justification. And then, what is the wedding garment? The wedding garment represents the character that all must possess who shall be accounted fit guests for the wedding. So the wedding garment, when Christ lives in you and works in you through the Holy Spirit, the character of Christ, the fruit of the Spirit, that is the wedding garment, the character. And the character is made up of thoughts and feelings. If the thoughts are wrong, the feelings will be wrong. And the thoughts and the feelings combined are your moral character. And that is why God wants his love to control us, so we can have the right character, the wedding garment. Let's read it from the Bible. We read in Revelation 19, 7 and 8, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of saints." But it's not just the saints producing it. It is the Christian abiding in Christ, letting Christ live in his heart, producing the fruit of the Spirit, which is the character of Christ. We read how to obtain it, Christ's Object Lessons, again, 312. When we submit ourselves to Christ, and that's when the marriage takes place, when there's a full submission of the heart to Christ, when we submit ourselves to Christ, the heart is united with his heart, the will is merged in his will, the mind becomes one with his mind, the thoughts are brought into captivity to him. We live his life. This is what it means to be clothed with the garment of his righteousness. It's not you producing the fruit. It's you so submitting to him that he can work in you his love. And that's the wedding garment, the character of Christ. Are you ready? Do you have the wedding garment on? All must pass the king. We read in 1 Testimonies 1:63, "Deal truly with your own soul. Remember that a church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing will Jesus present to his Father." And we read it in the Word of God, Ephesians 5:25-27. "Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word." You see, you are washed with water and the Spirit. "That he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. That's what Christ gave himself to do, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness and present us to his Father, a pure church. God will accept nothing but purity and holiness. One spot, one wrinkle, one defect in the character will forever debar them from heaven with all its glories and pleasures. You say, well, that is a hard saying. One defect in the character? Let's look at it in a very practical way. Here am I, thinking I'm on the road to heaven, and I have resentment toward my husband, and I won't give it up, and I knock at the door of heaven. Can Jesus let me in? With resentment here? No, that's a defect of character. That's a wrong feeling. And it comes as the result of a wrong thought, because the feelings follow the thoughts. And so I had to come to God and say, God, I give up my right to resent my husband. I have no right, no matter what he does. If I'm going to be a Christian, have no right to resent anyone, right? The Bible says, love your enemies. Do good to those that hate you and wrongfully use you. It doesn't say to resent them and get irritated with them. You see? And I didn't understand that. And so I had resentment for 20 years. Oh, it wasn't anything big. Some people carry a lot of bitterness, especially in broken homes. And it's very sad. And if they knock at the door of heaven, can they be allowed in with bitterness? No, that's a character defect. That's a wrinkle. No one can go to heaven with heart sins. And Jesus can cleanse them today. Today we can come to him. It doesn't take a lifetime. Today you can come with all your heart and say, Lord, here are all these wrong attitudes. Here's everything in my heart. I give it to you. Cleanse me. And he can do it today. Today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow you could be in the grave, right? You know, people have this wrong idea. Sanctification is the work of a lifetime. Let's keep working on trying to be good. That's legalism. That's evolution. Yeah. Christianity is the power of God to cleanse us today. You may not know all the outward things he wants you to do, but your heart can be right today. Do you see the difference? God looks at the heart. And then you learn to dress properly and eat properly and take care of your body properly. But the heart can be right the whole time. And so this has to do with the wedding garment, the thoughts and the feelings combined. That is your character. The righteousness of Christ, this is Desire of Ages 555. The righteousness of Christ is not a cloak to cover unconfessed and unforsaken sin. It is a principle of life. Look at the principle of life that transforms the character and controls the conduct. That is the righteousness of Christ. That is righteousness by faith. Allowing the Holy Spirit to so control you in the inner being that you have the character of Christ, the fruit of the Spirit. Holiness is wholeness for God. It is the entire surrender of heart and life to the indwelling of the principles of heaven. You know, the vine and the branch is Jesus' diagram of what it means to be a Christian. Christ in you is the hope of glory, not Christ knocking at the door, not self on the throne. And this is what the Laodiceans didn't know. They thought they were rich and increased with goods and had need of nothing. And they knew not that they were wretched, blind, and naked. They had not understood the gospel. They did not know how to come and die to self and sin and be born again so that Christ could live within. And so Jesus said, buy of me gold tried in the fire, purification. Buy of me white raiment, the wedding garment, the character of Christ. Buy of me eye salve that you might be able to see your true condition. And the eye salve is the word of God. The eye is your conscience. And so we will close for a little break, and then we will continue again for another hour. Let's have a little prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you have made it so plain. Help us, Father, that we may truly understand it and live by it every day. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. We've already had our prayer, and so we'll continue. You know, sometimes people come to the first meeting, like we just finished, and they don't come to the other meetings where I share how it works, and especially often people don't stay for the last two, which then helps them to see how to have victory and how and what happens if they fall. And then they say, well, I teach a gospel that is impossible to live. And it's not true. If we understand all the steps and we know just how Jesus works with us and treats us, even if we fall. All right, and so let's go into these steps that God has given us in his word, because he says in Philippians, through Paul, Philippians 2, 12 and 13, we read, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. What is the next part? For it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And very often, people are trying to work out their own salvation, trying to overcome, trying to have victory, without allowing God to work in them. And it's no use. It'll fail. But once we learn how to submit to God and let him work in us, then it's possible to overcome. And so it's very important we understand both parts. God has a part, man has a part. If you will read down God's part, all of God's part has to do with working in us, doing something within us to help us to come to this victory. All our part has to do with working out what God has already worked in. But it goes step by step. If we do not cooperate with God as he's trying to do his work, he cannot go any further. And he will just stay knocking at the door, pleading and trying to get our attention so that we can cooperate with him. And so number one, he will draw us. The Bible says in John 12, 32, I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. And so even before you are born, God is trying to help your parents to be drawn to him so that you could be brought up in a Christian home. And you think of John the Baptist. His parents were fully committed, filled with the Holy Spirit, and John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit from the mother's womb. And he walked with the Lord. He had a tremendous advantage over children who are born from parents who are not walking with the Lord. But every mother could have that privilege. But even if you were not born in that kind of home, God is drawing, wanting you to come into full relationship with him. And as we take time to listen to God and get to know him through the word, then he can even draw us better so that we can truly come to him. We read in Matthew 1:21, first of all, John 3:14 through 17. For God so loved the world that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And so God is in the business of saving people, not condemning them. He wants to save us. He is doing everything he can to save us if we will only cooperate with him. And so the very first thing is to help people to know God, to know Jesus, to know how much he loves us and how much he really cares. Many children have grown up in homes where they have not really been loved, and they cannot grasp the fact that the Father in heaven loves them and that Jesus cares about them. I've talked with many such people, and they have a hard time believing. And if they can't believe it, then God can't really draw them the way he would like to. And so it's very important that we share with people how much God loves us. He wants to save us. He's not there to keep us out of heaven. He's there to draw us into heaven. Amen. But he cannot save us in sin. It's just as simple as that. He has to save us from sin. The Bible says it very plainly. Matthew 1:21, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. So he didn't come to save us in sin. He came to save us from sin. He came to take away the bitterness, to take away the resentment, to take away the jealousy and the anger and the envy. That's what he came for. To take away sin. In One Selected Messages 3:22, during his 30 years of life on earth, his heart was wrung with inconceivable anguish. The path from the manger to Calvary was shadowed by grief and sorrow. Hating sin with a perfect hatred, he yet gathered to his soul all the sins of the world. What did he do with your sins? He had to gather them into his soul so he could feel the guilt of them and so he could die for them as though they were his own. You know, sometimes young people say, Jesus didn't have many temptations. Look at the world today. Jesus knew all the sins of mankind. Jesus had to gather them all into his soul and still keep himself pure. And he had to know them as if he had done them, as if he had indulged in them. And the pull, when he went into the wilderness, first of all, I'll read this. The guilt of every sin pressed its weight upon the divine soul of the world's Redeemer. The evil thoughts, the evil words, the evil deeds of every son and daughter of Adam called for retribution upon himself, for he had become man's substitute. That's what it meant, a substitute. He had to feel it all. He had to know it all. Though the guilt of sin was not his, his spirit was torn and bruised by the transgressions of men, and he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. You see, he was made sin that we might be made righteous. Sin was not just counted to him. No, he had to know it. And in the same way, righteousness is not just counted to us. No, we have to experience it. He came to make us righteous, not just call us righteous. It's for real. And he had to feel the sins of the world for real. We read, as soon as Christ entered the wilderness of temptation, the weight of the sins of the world was pressing his soul, and his countenance expressed unutterable sorrow. He felt the overwhelming tide of woe that deluged the world. He realized the strength of indulged appetite and of unholy passion which controlled the world. He felt it all, the pull of all those sins, so that he could save us. The humanity of Christ reached to the very depths of human wretchedness. That's when he became the sin bearer. Before that, as a child, he had to deal with sin as a child. But when he became the sin bearer, when he entered his ministry, and right from the wilderness on, he had to know what sin had done in people's lives. He had to feel the pull of it. In his closing hours while hanging upon the cross, he experienced to the fullest extent what man must experience when striving against sin. To the fullest extent, striving against sin, keeping himself pure. He realized how bad a man may become by yielding to sin. He realized the terrible consequences of the transgression of God's law. For the iniquity of the whole world was upon him. He was made sin that we might be made righteous. And so as we learn about Jesus and all that he went through for us, do not resist. It's easy to resist. especially if you don't know you're in a lost condition. I didn't know I was in a lost condition. And for years, the Holy Spirit tried to get through to me, study. God knew if I would only sit down and carefully study, I would realize my lost condition. But I was just a good girl. I had never gone out in the world. I loved obedience. My parents had no trouble with me. And so I took it for granted. I was a Christian. But I was just a good girl. And when I got married and had to deal with a husband and children, it wasn't as easy as it was when I was a young girl. And yeah, then I had resentment and some of these problems. But you see, doesn't everybody have those? And so I compared myself with others, and I didn't have a big problem. I didn't know I was not on the road to heaven. And so the Holy Spirit tried to get my attention, study, study. But I was so busy working for God. And my husband studies all the time. He's an editor. He's a minister. And so he was into books all the time. And he never came to me and he said, Margie, do you understand this? Have you experienced a new birth? Do you know what it means? No, because he himself didn't know. You see, you can study theology for 20, 30, 40, 50 years and never find the truth. You have to study to find God. You have to study to know how to be a Christian. Then you will find it. And so when I studied to help my father, well, I discovered it very quickly that I was a lost person. And it wasn't until my father cried for help that I really sat down to study. Then I stopped resisting. And then the Holy Spirit could get through to me. And very quickly he convicted me. Number two, he will convict us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Well, if I did a little sin, I was convicted. If I cheated on a test, I was convicted. I knew I had to confess. I knew I had to make it right. If I told a little lie to protect myself, I knew I had to make it right. And so I did. But it's not just sin that he convicts us of. Righteousness. Do we have the fruit of the Spirit? And as I was studying, I realized I have no righteousness. All my righteousness is just self-righteousness. And blaming others for my sins of irritation and impatience and anger and resentment. I had no righteousness. And then he convicted me. I was not ready for the judgment. And so then I really searched for my own soul, not just for my father. And as I searched, I found answers. That text was in John 16:8. He will convict us. And as he convicts us, what must we do? Acknowledge our guilt. Blame no one else. Acknowledge your guilt, the Bible says. In Jeremiah 3:12-13. Return, faithless Israel, says the Lord. I will not look on you in anger, for I am merciful, says the Lord. I will not be angry forever. Only acknowledge your guilt, that you rebelled against the Lord your God. Stop blaming others and say, I did wrong. When I have a wrong spirit, whose fault is it? No one else but mine. Why should I sin if someone else is sinning? If they are doing wrong, why should I go and help them to do wrong by getting angry with them? You see? We just have to think a little bit of what is happening here. Why should I sin because they are doing wrong? And why should I use Satan's power to correct them instead of God's power? Do you see? One or the other. We are using power. When we get angry, we are allowing Satan's power to control us instead of God's love. And so I acknowledged my sin. I acknowledged I was wrong. And I came to the Lord and I said, Lord, I give up my right to those sins, to have a wrong spirit. God reveals to us our guilt that we may flee to Christ and through him be set free from the bondage of sin. But you see, if we blame others, we'll never be set free. Never. It's impossible because God cannot do it. My father always blamed others. And so how could God help him? How could he ever be an overcomer? It was utterly impossible. And here he was at the end of his life. And that Sabbath when we were all together and we were talking about these things, in the evening, two of my sisters said, let's kneel in a family circle and let's confess to one another where we have wronged each other, so that there can be nothing between, because they had been deeply studying and they had been brought into deep repentance. They wanted nothing between the soul and the Savior. And so we were kneeling there, and one of my sisters looked up at Father, hoping he would confess how deeply he had wronged her. He couldn't do it. She didn't say a word, but he knew. Because people know, the guilty know just what sins to confess, that their hearts may be pure before God. Why? Because the Holy Spirit tells them, the Holy Spirit convicts them. Isn't the Holy Spirit wonderful to do that? Because if he didn't do that, we would keep on excusing our sins. But some people excuse them anyway and keep their guilt. Anyway, as my sister looked up at Father, he couldn't do it. He jumped up, he ran outside. And I jumped up and ran after him to protect him. Because I remembered from childhood that if Father had to take the blame, he would threaten to kill himself. And so I ran after him. I caught up with him in the dark. I put my arms around his neck. He was no taller than I, and I held him tight. And I prayed, Lord, what do I tell my father? And the Lord gave me strong words. I said, Dad, the reason you get so tense when all of your children come home for a visit is because you are so afraid we are going to talk about our childhood to one another. He never wanted to leave Mother alone with us because we might share some things. And I said, you have so deeply wronged your children. The only one you have not wronged is me. He thought for a moment. He said, Margaret, I have wronged you too. Well, yes. I can remember one time when I was very much wronged. I was milking cows and one cow was kicking like everything. And I was only about 13, and I was trying to keep that pail of milk from being knocked in the gutter, and all of a sudden the cow just lifted her foot and oof, and there the milk went. And my father came with a big rope and he gave it to me and the cow. He was so angry. We couldn't afford to lose that milk, which was true. But what could a little girl do? You see? And the father should have understood I was doing my best. But no, when things went wrong, he went out of control. But, yeah, and when I said this, and he acknowledged, I have wronged you too, what was he doing? What was he doing? Acknowledging his guilt. And then he took me into the house, into a room where the others weren't there, and he just poured out his guilt, even from his youth. He said, Margaret, the guilt is just crushing me. Help me. And I couldn't help him. I didn't know how to lead a sinner to the foot of the cross. I didn't know what to say to him. And I said nothing. And I went home to study, to find out what he needed. 4 years later, the Lord sent me back. But in the meantime, he also was deeply studying. And so it all came together. Acknowledge your guilt. He had even gone 2 years before I came back from India. He had gone to a minister and pleaded for rebaptism because the guilt was crushing him. He didn't know what to do with it. And the minister just rebaptized him, and that was it. And Father said the guilt got heavier. Why? Because he hadn't surrendered his heart. No one had taught him what was involved. And he was still excusing his sins. Anyway, it says the guilty know just what sins to confess that their hearts may be pure before God. Those who have not humbled their souls before God in acknowledging their guilt have not yet fulfilled the first condition of acceptance with God. The first condition. Acknowledge your guilt. The only reason we have not remission of sin, and remission of sin means the sin is taken away, the only reason we have not remission of sin is that we have not acknowledged to him whom we have wounded by our transgressions, whom we have pierced with our sins, that we are at fault. You see, we blame situations, we blame other people. How can we get rid of sin when we do that? It's impossible. There's no power there. And so this is very important. Acknowledge your guilt that you rebelled against the Lord your God. The confession that is the outpouring of the inmost soul will find its way to the heart of infinite pity. One Selected Messages, 3:26. The Lord is nigh to them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. Psalm 34:18. Come to Christ just as you are and contemplate his love until your heart is broken. If you're not ready to give him your heart today, do that. Come to him just as you are and study to know him until your heart is broken. until you can acknowledge, I am a sinner. I did wrong. If you have not already understood and come to him. When I began to understand these things and I was ready to go back to my father, I prayed, now Lord, send me back to my father. But I want you to have my family call me and have them offer to pay my way from Washington, D.C. to British Columbia, where most of them lived. And I didn't even tell my husband I was praying that, and I just prayed, Lord, I want you to be in charge. I want you to send me when it's time and open the door for me to go. And so I prepared myself. I made myself a little notebook and wrote down many things that I had discovered, and I believed the Lord would work it out. A couple of months later, one of my sisters called, and she said, Margaret, help me. What's wrong? My daughter has run away from home, 19-year-old girl. She's on drugs. She's with a man. I don't know what to do. I said, well, Tom and I have just discovered the Lord a few months ago. We feel for the first time we could help a sinner. Would she come and visit us? I don't know where she is, my sister said. I said, never mind. We'll pray. And we'll pray that if we can help her, God will send her. In 1 week, she was there. The fella had left her. She didn't know where to go. She went to mother, and mother said, your auntie would like you to visit. So here she was. But she hadn't come to find Christ. She came for a change of scenery. And when I looked at her and we tried to make a little conversation, I thought, well, Lord, how do you do it? How do you help a deliberate, stubborn, willful sinner? I didn't know how. And I prayed, Lord, you're going to have to open the door to her heart. I don't know how. And as I was praying and we were conversing a little bit, there was a knock at the door. And I went to the door, and there stood a Seventh-day Adventist minister's wife from right next door to us. We had just moved there. We didn't really know her. And she said, Margaret, I sense that you and your husband are finding something real in Christianity. I want it too. Will you share with me? Well, of course. And I invited her in, and we sat down, and I drew some pictures for her similar to this. I didn't have any of this done at that time. It was just at the beginning when I was starting to share. And we talked about these things and about the power of the gospel, and the whole time my niece was in the room. And I was not preaching at her. I was talking with this lady. And we had a wonderful conversation, and when the lady left, my niece turned to me and she said, Auntie, if there is that much power in the gospel, there's hope for me. I said, why do you say that? She said, you know me. You know how stubborn I am. I said, yes, I know. She said, I watched my parents. They didn't have victory. I watched my friends' parents. They didn't have victory. I watched my teachers. And her father was a church school teacher, and all her years of school were in church school. She said, I watched my teachers. They didn't have victory. And so I just decided, if they have tried all those years to have victory and it's still not there, I might as well give up right now and enjoy the world. And that's what I'm doing. And she said, I love sin, My conscience doesn't even bother me anymore. But if what you are saying is true, then there's hope for me. Can you imagine how I felt? The door was wide open. We had a good conversation, and I looked forward to weeks of sharing with her. The next day, the door was closed. And I did not force it. You know, our young people have been pushed and pushed and pushed to be good, to do what is right. But have we taught them how to come to Christ so they can have victory, so they can have power? Nobody taught me how to come to Christ. And I didn't teach my children either until I discovered the way. I taught them to be obedient. And if they weren't obedient, they were punished. We had the obedience of law, but we didn't have the obedience of faith. We didn't know how to lift our souls to receive power from above. And so I was sharing all these things with her, but the next day the door was closed. She went on the streets, she got a job at McDonald's, she did her own thing. We were living in Washington, D.C., and we didn't see her very often. She was in a bedroom in our downstairs, and she ate most of her meals at McDonald's, and she was running around. And we kept praying. We kept believing God had sent her. Then one day, I was on the phone with a very good friend of mine, a minister's wife. She had just run off with another minister and had left her husband and her three young sons, and I just felt terrible. I had gone to school with both of them, and so I pleaded with her to come back. No way. I spoke an hour with her, and I didn't realize it, that my niece had come into the room and was listening to the conversation. And after I got off the phone, my niece said, "Auntie, I sensed your disappointment. Aren't you disappointed with me?" I said, "Lord, tell me what to say. Here's another open door." I said, "No. I'm not disappointed. The Lord has long-range plans for you, and I am trusting the Lord." And I was. She heaved a sigh of relief, and she became more open to talk. I was not going to push her. And she felt more free. And we had another good conversation, but the next day she was out on the street again. And about a week later, she came in and brought a young man with her. And she said, "Auntie, I would like you to share the gospel with him." And I thought, well, here she's been into sin with him. And then she comes and wants me to share the gospel with him. But I did it anyway. I sat down. We had a good talk with him. He was very much into mystical religion. And yeah, it was very difficult to get through to his thinking. But anyway, after he left, I said to her, "What are you doing? You led him into sin. You spent the weekend with him. He's a married man. And now you bring him to me to teach him the gospel? What are you doing?" She said, "Auntie, I know now that there's enough power for people to be saved. Anyone except me." And so I began to pray, "Lord, show me what is the problem. Why does she still not feel savable? There are many young people who don't feel savable. My son didn't feel savable because everybody rejected him when he was little. He couldn't learn to read. He was dyslexic. And they were just teaching by memorizing words instead of teaching the ABCs. And the poor kid could only see two letters at a time, and they were backwards. Well, how could he learn to read? By memorizing words that he didn't even see. And so he was treated as dumb and stupid, and his teachers rejected him through the years. I gradually did my very best to help him get through it, but finally, when I had discovered this and we were talking, and someone gave me a book on dyslexia, and I said, whoa, that's his problem. No teacher had known it. And nowadays, yeah, they pick it up very quickly, but then they didn't. And so I went to him and I gave him a book to read upside down. And I said, read to me, Arlen. He started to read and he laughed because, Mom, it's upside down. I said, it's okay, read. He started to read. He said, Mom, I can see a whole line at a time. You see, he was reading backwards. A dyslexic person's eyes go the opposite direction and they don't even know what is wrong. And here they're supposed to read this way instead of this way. And then I told him what his problem was, and he said, oh, Mother, everybody thought I was dumb or lazy. The only one who still had faith in me was you. And I thank God I tried. But I was hard on him too. I would get upset and I would be impatient. But I did my best to try to help him through school. But, you know, then when I discovered this way and discovered his problem, I gave him Desire of Ages and I said, Arlen, read Desire of Ages. It'll help you. Finally, he decided he would do it. And he said the Lord helped him. It wasn't hard reading. And when he finished, he came to me and he said, Mom, isn't it wonderful that God loves me? You see? Until you can believe that God loves you personally, how can you open your soul to give yourself fully to God? You can't. And so it's very important to know. Anyway, here was my niece, and I started praying, Lord, show me, why does she still not feel she can be saved? And I didn't find the answer. And here was the last day she was with us. She was saying goodbye. And I said, Lord, please show me the answer. And the Lord gave me these words. I said, if you ever want to follow Jesus, don't start by trying to get rid of your sins. Start by sitting at the feet of Jesus. Get to know him. Spend hours with him in the Word. And let his Spirit work on you. And that's what we read here. Come to Christ just as you are and contemplate his love until your hard heart is broken. Well, she didn't say she would do it. She didn't say she wanted to follow Jesus. Anyway, she went home, and we kept praying. 2 months later, she phoned. She said, Auntie, I've done what you told me to do. For 2 months, I have been sitting at the feet of Jesus. I have just spent all my hours reading the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy. And she said, I can hardly believe what the Lord is doing. My whole heart and mind are being drawn to Jesus, and I don't even care about sin anymore. Who had done it? God had done it. Why? Why could he not do it before? She didn't know him. She had to get to know him. She had to let him work on her heart so that he could bring her to surrender. He gave her repentance. You see, repentance is a gift from God. You can't work it up in your own heart, but God can do it. And we read here in this same statement, it is the virtue that goes forth from Jesus which strengthens the purposes of the heart to turn away from sin and to cleave to that which is truth. It is Christ's virtue that makes repentance sincere and genuine. And so she had genuine repentance. And her mother saw the change in her, and in a few weeks her mother called and she said, Margaret, what my daughter has learned, I want to learn too. Will you come west if I pay your way and teach us? I was so excited because now the door was open to go back to my family and to share with them. And then another brother called and he said, Margaret, I hear you're coming as far as Walla Walla to share with the family there. Will you also come to British Columbia if I pay the rest of the way? So two calls, and then a third call came. And so I knew I could go to all my family, and God was arranging it. And I shared with them what I will share with you the rest of the time that we are here. He will give you repentance. It is a gift from God. And then you can confess and forsake your sins. And when he gives you repentance and he works in your heart so that you don't want sin anymore, like he did with my niece's heart, then it's not hard to give up your sins and to come and confess and make things right. Godly sorrow worketh repentance. The sorrow of the world worketh death. There are many people who have the sorrow of the world. What is the sorrow of the world? Oh, you feel bad because you hurt someone, but not because it hurt Jesus. Not because you really want to turn away from the sin. But true repentance makes us want to turn away from the sin and give them all to Jesus. We read in Proverbs 28:13, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesses and forsakes them shall have mercy. Confess and forsake. This is a big step. Not just confess your sins and forsake them, but give your whole heart to Jesus. This is where full surrender should take place. Because just to give up one or two sins is not enough. He says, give me your heart. I want you. I don't want only your sins. Christ is able to cleanse to the uttermost all who come to him in faith. He will cleanse them from all defilement if they will let him. But if they cling to their sins, they cannot possibly be saved. For Christ's righteousness covers no sin unrepented of. And what is repentance? Saying, Lord, here it is. I'm ready to give it up. Christ never covers sin in us. He takes away the sin. Then he covers us with his righteousness. Take away the filthy garments, put on him white garments, the Bible says. But first of all, he must take away the filthy garments. There are many, this is Desire of Ages, no, Christ Object Lessons 97. There are many who try to reform by correcting this or that bad habit. They hope in this way to become Christians, but they are beginning in the wrong place. Our first work is with the heart. Our first work. You see, and many people have given up all kinds of sins of the world, but they've never given the heart sins. Never given the heart. My son, give me your heart. This is from Steps to Christ 43. The whole heart must be yielded to God, or the change can never be wrought in us by which we are to be restored to his likeness. By nature, we are alienated from God. The Holy Spirit describes our condition in such words: we are dead in trespasses and sins. We are held captive by Satan at his will. You see, we are born in a lost world. Unless we give ourselves to Christ, we are automatically the slaves of Satan. God desires to heal us, to set us free. But since this requires an entire transformation, a renewing of our whole nature, we must yield ourselves wholly to him. The warfare against self is the greatest battle that was ever fought. You know, it's quite easy to give up this and this and this sin. But what about the self? The warfare against self is the greatest battle that was ever fought. The yielding of self, surrendering all to the will of God, requires a struggle, but the soul must submit to God before it can be renewed in holiness. So before God can give you a new heart and a new mind, you have to give him the old one. Makes sense, doesn't it? And so we have to come and say, Lord, here I am. Take me as I am. I give all myself to you. I give all my heart sins to you. I give up all right to act by my lower nature. That's what it means to die to self, to give up your right to act by Satan's ways. The Bible puts it this way: put off, this is Ephesians 4, 22 through 24, put off your old nature, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and put on the new nature, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. It's a new creation. How long does it take God to create a new heart and a new mind? He speaks the word. Yeah. It is supernatural. It's a miracle. But how long does it take man to come to surrender? To come to repentance? It could take years. It doesn't have to. When my niece understood and allowed God to work in her heart, she came willingly. It was supernatural. God was leading her. But if we keep on resisting and don't let the Holy Spirit work with us, then it could take a long time. And when we don't understand what's involved, my mother-in-law didn't understand what was involved. She became an Adventist when my husband was about 11, but she never understood. And then once we understood, we went to her, we tried to share. She couldn't understand. She was already old, And she was in an old folks home, and she had gone there when we were in India, and we couldn't seem to make her understand. And then Salvation Army person came along, Salvation Army preacher, and he was visiting all the old people in the nursing home, and he said to her, "Have you ever given your heart to Jesus?" She thought. She didn't know. And so he said, "Would you like to do it now?" She said, "Yes." And she was a different person. They called her the miracle woman in the nursing home. She was very different. She had finally surrendered her heart. She started reading her Bible. She started singing hymns. She started doing things. She was 93 at the time. And as soon as we came to visit her, we knew immediately something had happened to her. She was not the same person. And she had experienced the new birth. She lived to be 104. And so it doesn't matter how old you are, but you see, you have to come, you have to believe, you have to surrender. And God can bring you to that place if you spend time with Him, just as you are. Just spend lots of time with Him, and He will break your heart, and He will bring you to repentance. He will bring you to the place where you want to give up self, and it won't be too hard. The Bible says, Romans 6:11, "So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus." And so we want to come to the foot of the cross. And we'll continue tomorrow. May the Lord bless you as you think on these things, and allow Him, if you haven't already come to the foot of the cross, allow Him to bring you there. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank You that You love us so much and You don't give up. You continue to work with each one of us and help each of us to know our condition and to be truly committed to You. Thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.